Hi, it's Robert Promisel, Resolution Capital. I'm here with Shank Mitra, the CEO and CIO of Welltower. Welltower is a $45 billion company listed in the New York Stock Exchange. It's one of the largest owners of healthcare real estate in the world, with operations in the US, in Canada, UK. About two-thirds of the portfolio are senior housing assets, just over 20% of medical office buildings, and the balance is spread across a range of skilled nursing and post-acute care facilities. So good afternoon, Shank. Thank you for sharing some time with us today. Really interested in hearing your perspective on your company. And I just thought we'd maybe start off focusing on your larger segment, senior housing. Maybe you could just delve into that and talk about the types of senior housing assets that Welltower owns and operates. And what is it about seniors housing that makes it such a compelling asset class at this point?
Good afternoon, Rob. Thank you for having me. As you mentioned, Welltower is the largest owner of healthcare-related asset and infrastructure in the world. And senior housing is a particularly interesting asset class. There are very few times in the history of all asset classes where you see a cyclical opportunities that merge with a secular opportunity. And at the same time, you see a tremendous, from a demand side, and you see a tremendous opportunity to professionalize a business. So let me dig into that. So from the, you know, sort of one at a time. So what happened in last decade, sort of you call it, you know, our clientele is we own a lot of assisted living and some independent living, you know, type assets in Canada, but a lot of assisted living assets in US and UK. What happened is, if you think about sort of the aging of the baby, you know, population, you would have noticed that there was a sort of a lull in population growth of our target customers last decade. And that just happens to be because of sort of the birth rate went down significantly, what we call silent generation, the so-called 1928 to 1937. So you have a natural sort of that curve coming of age starting 2020, 2021, sort of that time frame, and it goes, that curve goes, you know, just that grows significantly that population for next 10, 15, 20 years, frankly 30 years, right? Sort of that sort of one. So we're at that precipice, we're at the cusp of a significant secular growth from a demand perspective. On the other hand, very front end, this is the first inning of a 30-year run that just started or just about to start, right? So that's from the demand perspective. On the supply side, given what happened, you know, in the exuberance of, you know, in sort of expecting that demand, what happened the supply side last decade, so many people have lost so much money. And now, you know, sort of that spigot stopped in 18 and 19 with a lot of assets that were sort of built but not filled up, and is starting to slowly go to the peak, you know, sort of that peak through the Python concept. And it is exactly when COVID hit, right? So so if you think about the situations were not for not highly, very well capitalized people were not great, that's when COVID hit and take the rug out of, under them, right? So that's what happened. So supply has materially calmed down. And in, obviously in our markets, you think about it, in coastal markets where we are, it takes 2 to 3 years of pre-development, 2 to 3 years to build something. So once the supply cycle stops, it takes 5, 6 years to sort of get back to that level. So you have an interesting opportunity where both from a demand and supply, things are really looking really great. That's sort of both demand supply overall. Now you think about, let's go back decades and think about McDonald's, right? Think about it, Ray Kroc and the McDonald's brothers. Great, great sandwich, great shake, great fries. And but it took decades of professionalism to bring it to McDonald's today, right? This business is 30, 40 years behind of professional housing management, if you will, apartments and other asset classes. So we think we're also sort of at the front end, the very front end of professionalizing this business. So if you put all these things together, I couldn't be more excited about the business. You know, from one, from professionalizing the business, at the same time, you have a massive demand tailwind. And frankly speaking, it's too late to sort of bring in the supply to stop that sort of demand outstripping supply. It's just because of that, how long it takes. So we're very, very excited about the prospect.
How about senior housing penetration? Not only is the pie growing, but imagine the need is going to be changing as well.
So historically, senior housing penetration, has increased, call it about 50 basis points every decade. So call it, it's like watching paint dry. You know what I mean? It was just a 5 basis points movement. Something radically changed in last, call it 5 years. So if you look at demand growth, and this is for this discussion, I'm going to focus on assisted living in US, because that's where the most data is. And that's where majority of our portfolio is. If you look at demand growth in assisted living in United States in the last 5 years, you will see that grew about 3 times our population growth, which has been pretty anemic. Population has been growing, like you call it 1.25%, and demand grew 3.5%, right? And what is that difference? Is the penetration rate, right? So not only there are more people, there are a higher percent of the people are accessing the product. Why is that? Because as people, longevity is increasing, and if you think about what happened in the workforce in the United States, as an example, is mobility has increased significantly as families are in different places versus where the parents are. You know, that had played a huge role into it. And the second is, even if you are super wealthy and you could afford the service that we provide, we have a product in senior living in US, which is very high end, but given the lack of availability of labor to provide that one-on-one care has become so expensive, scaling of that in a community setting has become even more beneficial. And then you add that with what we think is one of the most important part of what we provide, our communities provide, is the social interaction, right? Which you can't do any other setting. And so putting all together, that understanding that loneliness is a very big determinant of social determinants of health, that awareness has created an even more robust sort of demand for our product. So you're talking about, Rob, a topic that's very near and dear to my heart, because if you think if there is awareness of the product, what it can be, let's look at where senior housing penetration has been probably higher than any place that I know in the 3 countries we do business in: Quebec, the province of Quebec in Canada, where you have a nudge from the government. Government doesn't pay for it, but there's a tax benefit, which is a nudge. And penetration rate is above 20%. Average penetration rate in US is like 10 to 11%. So it sort of gives you a sense of the art of the possible. And I think you're going to continue to see that penetration rate continue to go up.
So additional segmentation, specialization within senior housing as well. Yeah, one thing that's interesting is thinking about the scale of these communities, and maybe you could just talk a bit about how that's changed over time.
Yeah, so I think communities have gotten bigger, from the perspective of at least where we focus on, purely because the amenities that we focus on from the socialization perspective, cost of construction has continued to creep up so significantly last decade, particularly last, call it 3-4 years, to provide that same package of interaction. And, you think about assisted living building, the amount of white space you have where it's not a living unit is significantly larger than a lot of asset classes. So for that to be affordable somewhat to people, you need scale, right? So, we're used to see a lot of 40 unit, 60 unit boutique kind of units. We don't see that anymore. We see more 100 units, 150 units. All the way we're going up in Canada, we see 300-400 unit, communities. But the sweet spot really depends on who you are, in what market, what product you're offering. For larger communities, I personally like a continuum of care, like some independent living, some assisted living, some memory care. But communities have been getting bigger over a period of time, as you mentioned, to make sense of the cost environment. And obviously, cost environments of construction cost and cost environment scaling of the labor, So, but I think we probably have found that sort of what the sweet spot is. And United States today, it feels like it's more like 100 to 200 units, and probably around 125, 150 is sort of the sweet spot for, you know, in, you know, a given market and operate. Obviously, it depends on different place for different people.
So it's an interesting blend of operational scale, specialization, additional amenities, all of which will interact to impact penetration and as the market opportunity grows.
Correct.
Yeah.
And, you know, from our perspective, you know, from our perspective, we bring in another level of value add to this business, which is, as you know, Rob, that we have built the biggest and the most sophisticated predictive analytics platform inside any real estate company on the globe. You know, 20 now at this point, probably 28, 30 data scientists working full time to bring in a very basic sense of what real estate should be. You know, historically, people say real estate is about location, location, location. And we think real estate is about matching the right location with the right product at the right price point, which is, frankly speaking, is it's more of a computer science and statistics problem, just the people gut feel problem, right? The way historically it's been dealt with. So we bring into that business, along with the professionalization of the business that I talked about. So we think the opportunity here is meaningful. You know, you think about how big that asset class is and where we deal with in the three countries and the minuscule market share we have, and the opportunity for growth is very significant.
So maybe we could talk a little bit about future possibilities for the company. Going back to your earlier point, a lot of the demand was demographically driven demand. We're in the front end of this multi-decade generational shift that's going on. That would presumably be applicable for more than just senior housing. You have assets in medical office. It's really about the, to borrow a phrase you used earlier, continuum of care type of approach. So how is it that you, you're focused right now on senior housing, medical office building? What are your, what do you think is possible? What are your expectations? What are your ambitions in this area?
Yeah, so you think about the three areas that we're very focused on. On housing side, you know, sort of what we focused on, what you are obviously talking about is seniors housing, which is an average customer is 75 years old, and we're focused on high price point, and we're focused on in the cost, right? So that's one big business. Another business where we're the largest owner of this asset class and we're growing that business very significantly, what I call wellness housing, which is housing for mature renters, but they're apartments, but the target customer age is 55, 65, 45 instead of 75, right? That's sort of a business that we're growing very significantly. And, you know, and we're the largest owner of that asset class. And there's not a lot of institutional capital that has been, you know, focused on that asset class. And we've been trying to scale that in a significant way. Medical office, you know, which is a pretty good business that over a period of time that I like. However, medical office business right now, we're not growing. But you have seen me growing that business gangbusters in 18 and 19. When there was an air pocket in the market, I bought 9 million square feet of medical office and billions of dollars of investment in that. Right now, capital chases what just worked in the last 12 months, 18 months, 24 months, right? So if you think about during the COVID time, that asset class has been one of the top performing asset class. So institutional capital is chasing that asset class to a price that I think makes no sense, right? So in that business, right? And again, going back to if it takes $500, $400 to build a building and the market is $600, I'm not going to be the person who's going to be buying, participating in that, unless there is a very, you know, specific deal that's going on in a specific place. We are focused in the medical office at growing that business through relationships and through development right now. We have like 1 million to 2 million square feet of fully leased, you know, medical office development that's underway. And we are focused right there. We occasionally find smaller opportunities where people need other solutions. You have a estates situation, you have a tax situation, you have an operator situation. So we continue to grow, but it, you know, sort of pales in comparison to sort of what we are doing in the senior housing side. And the reason we can do it in the senior housing side, Rob, not just what happened because of COVID, but remember what I said, the setup was there before COVID because of the construction boom that happened prior to COVID. So people are hanging by the thread and banks were kicking the can and kicking the can, and boom, COVID happened and the rug just pulled out of under them. So now we have a situation which I don't believe I've ever seen, that new asset trade at a discount to old assets. Why new assets trade at a discount to old assets? Because brand new assets, no lender is going to lend against it because it never had a history of a debt service coverage ratio. So no one will touch it. No, you know, no lender is touching it. And we're the unsecured borrower. We're the only people who can come in with an operator, with a full stack capital solution to take people out of these scenarios. And we can, we're long-time investors. So that's what's going on. Tomorrow, that situation can change again, right? We are already seeing the cooling off in the medical office side of the business, where institutional capital suddenly go, you know, coming off their slumber and said, oh my God, the, you know, inflation is above 2.5%, and this thing has 2.5% escalator. Why am I paying 4 cap for this asset? That is happening as we speak. So if we look forward 6 months, 12 months, 18 months, 24 months, when prices come to a place where it makes sense for the growth, where an IRR investor on an unlevered basis, as we talked about, will engage in that business again.
So that raises an interesting question, because essentially you've said that medical office building can't outgrow inflation. And yet in senior housing, you've come from a near-death experience, not really death, but, you know, 1,300 basis point loss in occupancy in the early stages of COVID, when the whole senior housing industry had very big challenges in leasing and occupancy fell. You've now stabilized that occupancy and are growing it again. And what's been perhaps one of the most pleasant surprises of this process is lately that you actually have pricing power as you're growing occupancy.
Yep. And Rob, the reason it's a surprise, because there is no other asset class, there is no other example, I think, that you can come up with globally where your occupancy is in the 70s and you have massive pricing power, right? That's why it's a surprise, because for you to get pricing power in most markets, people think the occupancy needs to be in the 90s pricing power, right? And, you know, and as you know, in US, we're talking about pricing increases like high single digit, you know, 6, 8, 10%. So we can outpace inflation in a significant way, or, you know, so it's an interesting opportunity for, you know, my investors and my owners, people like you, to not only sort of participate in an asset class where we're growing significantly. We bought more than $6 billion of the senior living assets. One excitement of that is we bought it at 50, 60 cents on the dollar because of the near-death experience that you talked about. And we're the, pretty much the only big player that sort of, you know, is in a significant growth mode in that business. But also, you know, we're doing it in a point in time where you are seeing real pricing power, right? So from a, because the value proposition of what we offer is increasing every day, and the ability to pay is increasing from the consumer perspective. Why? Because senior living is funded through sale of housing, not through income, right? And housing market, you know, has ripped, right? You know, call it last 3 years, last 4 years. And so our seniors are sitting on massive, unprecedented amount of housing wealth that now they're tapping into to say, okay, like I can actually afford to live in these places and last few years of my life in a great way, much more than I thought, because my house I thought is worth $500,000 and I get 5 bids, so it's $1 million, right? So that is happening. And I think we're at the very front end of that, because if you look at the R squared, look at the correlation of senior housing pricing power versus housing, you know, sort of housing wealth and housing level of housing prices, it's like a delay of, call it the R squared is extremely strong, but with a delay of like 12, 18, 24 months. And so the first phase of the pricing power we are seeing is because of the movement happened probably 2 years ago. And you know how much housing prices have moved in the last 2 years. And we think we're just at the front end of that.
Shank, this has been great. I wanted to just ask you one last question. as you know better than I, ESG has become such an important topic of late. And I know that you guys have been involved with it before it was popularized, as have we. But maybe you could just talk a little bit about how some of the environmental considerations have impacted your business and how you're maybe rethinking some of your investments or operations.
Yep. Look, ESG is not only the right thing to do, it is also right business decision to do, right? In terms of environmental perspective, we're very focused on, you know, energy, water. You know, we're making sure that all of our communities, as well as medical office, you know, we can make it solar ready, EV ready, and all of those things. Because our consumers, not only, as I said, is the right thing to do, is also what our consumers are demanding. It is also lowers our operating costs, right? So we are in the process of rolling out this across the board and on pace with all the goals that we have set up. On the social side, which sort of gets a little bit muddied, you know, in this discussion, I think that there are very few asset classes you can find globally where it has a bigger social impact than what we do, because we take care of the elderly, right? And I know that just sort of doesn't fit into the metrics and how other people rate these things, but I want you to sort of take a step back and think about the social impact of what we do. And from a governance perspective, you know, as you know, I'm very big on having the right governance from a board perspective, as well as if you look at, you know, so inside the company investment committee, what kind of authority people have, so that not one person, whether that person is me or you, have the authority to do, you know, whatever that person he or she wants, right? And that sort of brings a different conversation of diversity. And as you know, that we have one of the most diverse boards globally amongst, you know, all listed companies, and all of those things that, you know, we're pushing this forward because we fundamentally believe, and, you know, a diverse company and a diverse board creates a conversation that not only focuses on the right risk, but also the right opportunity, right? So we're very focused on that. We want to be forefront of this, and we're pushing this forward every single day.
Shank, this has been a terrific time. Thank you. Shank Mitra, CEO of Welltower, thank you very much for your time today.
Thank you for inviting me, Rob.
Great. Have a good day.